Well, hello everybody, this is Data Driven Formula One, and again Patrick Hens and Ganna Pogrebna here. Hello.
Hello Ganna, everybody at home, or wherever you see us, hear us.
Yeah, it's good, as always, good to see everyone, and especially great to talk to Patrick about today's character, which is Phil Hill. And as usual, when it comes to Ferrari drivers, I'm not very knowledgeable. I mean, maybe the only driver I know quite a lot about is Michael Schumacher, unsurprisingly. But yeah, so today we're talking about Phil Hill, not to be confused with Graham Hill or Damon Hill. This is the American guy, born again in 1927, and he passed away only in 2008. Yeah, so he is lived a very long life.
Exactly, yeah. And I think this is also something what we will speak about his character a little bit later on, because maybe he wasn't such an aggressive driver as many others. Mm-hmm. And practically as conclusion, he won 3 times Le Mans. So maybe he was a little bit more an expert on endurance racing, even if he was also successful in Formula One.
Yeah, Patrick, if you could go back to the previous photo. Yeah, I just want to say, when we talked about this episode with Patrick before we started recording, and basically we discussed how it's very difficult to find any photos of this guy. I mean, there is one photo from kind of later years on Wikipedia, which kind of we will also demonstrate here, kind of in the public photo in the public domain. But when you try to find like some proprietary photos, it's very difficult to find anything. I mean, he's always at the driving wheel, so there's not inside the circuit somewhere, so you can't really find like casual photos of him like we saw with previous drivers. You know, like we could actually find some maybe childhood photos and all that kind of stuff. So Phil Hill wasn't definitely the guy who really liked cameras, and you mostly could see him, all the photos that we have, he's actually inside the car driving, or he's working.
Exactly, he wasn't a very outgoing person. So let's say for a driver, he was quite shy, because normally most of the drivers have been quite outgoing characters going to the extreme, and Phil Hill was driving not that often, maybe 100% at the limit, which made him a very successful driver in endurance racing like Le Mans, the 12 hours of Sebring. And also this was surely a factor which contributed that he lived a long life, in opposite to many other drivers of that time.
Mm-hmm. And if I'm not mistaken, I might be mistaken there, but he actually, when he started for Ferrari initially, he was, I mean, we will talk about this, we'll come to this, right? But he was first like a test driver, right? Is that correct? So he wasn't really like competing for quite a while, or am I?
I don't know, but at least he started for Ferrari, or maybe earlier in endurance racing before he was the shorter Formula One.
Yeah. But I mean, and again, this is absolutely amazing, because this guy is from Miami, Florida. I mean, this should have been like really, it's completely the opposite of what we would expect from kind of stereotypical person from Miami. But definitely, very sort of serious, methodical kind of person, nevertheless, really interesting things happened in his career, even some scandals that we're going to discuss. So but in a sense, and another important thing that Patrick actually mentioned here on the slide is that he is the only American-born driver to win Formula One championship. That still kind of remains, I think, right? This sort of, this is still the case. So there was, there was someone else whose okay, you do have it there, like Mario and Andretti, yeah. Yeah. That's another person who was American, but he was not American born, so he was a naturalized citizen. Yeah. But I mean, this is the only American person.
Right. So he was born in Miami, but later lived in California, so he really was used to sun and the coastal states. As you know, Formula One is not that popular in the US than in Europe. And nevertheless, we had quite a number of good drivers in the end of the 50s, beginning of the 60s, for example, also Dan Gurney. But he was the first one who had been at the right time in the right car, which is always needed. And this combined with his driving skills supported that he became the 61 champion.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, of course, the 24-hour Le Mans had must have had a lot more Americans, right?
Yes.
So there is this famous thing with Ford versus Ferrari, and right. Like so, Americans definitely competed in Le Mans, and I'm sure that I'm not actually knowledgeable on the stats, so you have to forgive me, but I'm pretty sure there were some winners of 24 Le Mans who were Americans. But he was exceptionally good at that. He was just, you know, to win Le Mans three times, I mean, that's a lot.
Exactly. And also he was very successful at the 12 hours from Sebring, where you see here the photo in the Testarossa.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, they're definitely, you know, the person who could really drive for a very, very long time. And as we explained before, in Formula One, a lot of drivers actually also competed in Le Mans, and some actually came from Le Mans to, you know, Formula One, to compete in Formula One. And, you know, this was quite a usual pathway. And we already, when we discussed the 1950s with Patrick, we mentioned that, you know, what happened in Le Mans was actually affecting the, for example, safety, you know, regulations in Formula One, and kind of the big accidents also affected the way, you know, the way Formula One was, you know, conducted and ran back in the day. So it was all like very, very connected back then. Exactly. Currently, I bet, you know, some of the Formula One fans do not even know what 24-hour Le Mans is. It's quite possible.
Yeah, but I mean, still, a lot of the drivers see the importance, the image of Le Mans. And we have the triangle, the three races, which the most important one. We have the Grand Prix of Monaco, the 24 hours of Le Mans, and the 500 miles of Indianapolis. And for example, we see Alonso, who had the dream to win all of these three races. He won Formula One of Monaco, he won Le Mans, so he's still trying on the 500 miles on Indianapolis.
Yes. for better or worse.
Yes. I mean, now that he's changed to back to Renault, I don't know if he can continue in Indianapolis as in the past it was with his McLaren team, but we will see if he still will reach this.
Yes, time will tell.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
So, what you already mentioned, born in 1927 in Miami, But then the family moved to the other extreme, to Santa Monica, California, where he lived practically his whole life. Also interesting, he was maybe some of the smartest guys in the races. So he finished high school and even started studying business administration at the University of Southern California, where he stayed for 2 years, even when he became a member of the famous Kappa Sigma fraternity. Mm-hmm. But then he left the university to pursue his dream auto racing. And similar to others, for example, Jack Brabham, mm-hmm. he started becoming a mechanic, working on a race car. And with this, he became already in young years involved. And as it was necessary to become a famous race car driver, you had to move to Europe, particularly to England. And he started as a trainee as a Jaguar in 1949. And slowly he worked his way up, having a good reputation, and then signed with Ferrari in 1956.
Mm-hmm.
A long time.
So did it, do you think it had to do, it probably had to do with the fact that they lost Alberto Ascari, and so that, you know, in 1956 and all that, so... do you think that as we discussed originally, there were primarily Italian drivers kind of driving for Italian teams, right? And then it opened opportunity for, I mean, the tragic, rather tragic events opened an opportunity for drivers of other nationalities to be sort of working and driving for.
Enzo Ferrari started quite early to looking for good drivers from mm-hmm. the island. I mean, we had Mike Horton, mm-hmm. for example, also yes. at the end of the 50s.
Yes, exactly. And as we discussed before as well, Stirling Moss was hoping to get a drive, and with his dad, they traveled all the way to Italy just to find out that they're not going to be driving that day.
Yeah. But also, as we discussed, I mean, practically he had a drive for the 62 season.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, due to his accident, he wasn't able to start that year.
Yeah, that's right. So, but I mean, it kind of, got... when coming back to Phil Hill's career, indeed, that's a cool thing that, you know, he went to university, which was quite unusual. I mean, the majority of drivers that we've discussed, they either went to some sort of kind of community college or equivalent, and the studies were very, very kind of related to engineering. Right. So in Phil Hill's case, it was completely different. Kind of reminds me, you know, I have this friend who used to be an athlete. So he just did some windsurfing. And then at the age of 40, he decided that he wanted to be an economist, you know, for no good reason. Like he just one day woke up and decided to do a PhD in economics. So that's kind of, I mean, it's a sort of similar decision, but of course, you know, he liked cars from early age, obviously. And, growing up in the States helps, because you can drive, you can start driving relatively early.
With 15, depending in which state you are.
Yes, precisely. And, that helped. But then, to kind of completely change your career and go as a, effectively as an apprentice to Jaguar is it's quite a bit of a shift.
Yeah. Yeah. And you see here, I mean, he started at Jaguar, a team which up to the 1960s was not in Formula One, but successful in the endurance races.
Yeah, and we saw Jaguar cars quite a lot throughout, this series. And, even coming back to Mike Horton's death, who died actually in a Jag. Definitely beautiful cars that they produced. And I'm sure there was a lot to learn from Jaguar.
Yep.
But he also got lucky because eventually he went to Ferrari.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so practically he made his debut in Formula One already in 1958.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. And that's what I was asking. Like, I don't actually know. Like, actually, guys, if any of you know this, so what was happening between 56 and 58? So I thought he was kind of this, third driver or, sort of testing person.
Yeah, I assume he was more active in the endurance races. Mm-hmm. As you remember, and as we discussed, the race teams in opposite to today, they're not limited to one series. We had Ferrari, for example, is active in Formula One in the famous Le Mans, Sebring, but also still in the classic Italian street races like the Mille Miglia, Targa Florio. So they need a big number of drivers, and normally you start in the lower level races, and if you are successful, then you get invited to, let's say, Le Mans or Sebring or up to Formula One.
Yeah, and normally, I mean, these guys obviously drove in quite a few different events, but also in Formula 2, right? But I don't know about like what was happening to Phil Hill when he, like, starting from when he signed up and when he actually had his debut. That's what I'm like.
Yeah, and you're right. Also, there's still already had existing the Formula 2, and there had been the Formula 2 Ferraris.
Mm-hmm. Yes, so
there,
yes.
There had been different opportunities what you can do before you enter Formula One or Le Mans or other famous races.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting and also quite usual at that time, drivers hadn't been exclusive at one team. So if Ferrari, for example, you not offered you a possibility for Formula One, you could start with Maserati, buy your own Maserati. As it, as we saw it often, there had been a higher number of private Maserati teams in the Formula One, practically until the beginning of the 1960s. And here, he, for example, he drove together with Oliver Gendebien, very famous and experienced driver. And already early, he became the first American-born winner also of the 24 Hours of Le Mans. So even if we had Americans before, also here, he was the first American born. This skills, especially for difficult conditions like driving at the night, in the rain, and especially the combination of driving in the rain in the night, which is even special.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so again, kind of coming back to the driving ability, and probably this was the reason why he won Le Mans three times.
Exactly.
he was just very good at this long distance racing.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So first time he won it in 61 and 62, the same time years where he also was active for Ferrari in Formula One.
Mm-hmm.
After 62, he left Ferrari maybe for different reasons. First of all, I mean, the Formula One season was not very successful in 62. This for, again, for a number of arguments. First of all, the team was, I'm sure, negatively impressed by the fatal accident of from Wolfgang von Trips, where not only the driver died, but also 15 spectators in Monza. It was the last race before the 62 season, because Ferrari not went to the final race to the US in the 61 season. So you stayed with the impression of this big fatal accident the whole time you developed the car, the team for the next season. So this has a big influence. Also, we had problems with the labor union that year. So due to this, Ferrari couldn't participate at two races, which of course also didn't help. And also, and we will discuss it a little bit later, we had the walkout of similar key employees, key engineers, which left Ferrari. And due to this, this knowledge had been lost, which could have, with Ferrari could bounce back as they had some very talented young engineers in the second room, which stepped up and took over responsibility for the Formula One development, also continued development of the Le Mans cars. But for the 62 season, this was really a negative impact, which all factors together lead to a very unsuccessful Formula to one season. Mm-hmm. If something what's quite normal, quite human, if there's no success, of course the culture, the atmosphere is suffering. He also had some problems with his race engineers. I think it was one of the Italian races, where he complained about the car, and the race engineer just answered him that as a Formula One champion, you should be able to shift.
To drive anything.
Not drive anything, but to correctly shift the car. And I think this was the last thing which triggered that.
The last straw.
With Ferrari.
You know, I really like this argument. You are the Formula One champion, so you should be able to drive just pretty much, you know, anything.
Exactly, and this lead.
Here's a piece of metal. Drive.
Exactly, and as he, let's say, left Ferrari a little bit unhappy. Not surprisingly, maybe also because he didn't found another option at another British team. He joined the rebel employees from RTS to drive for the 63 season for this completely new team. Unfortunately, without success from the 10 races, or they only participated in five. And from the five where he really started, only one race he could finish. And this, I think, was Monza. And he only finished on the 11th position. So really another bad development for him. After already the bad luck in 62, already 63 become worse. After this, he stayed still until 66. Mm-hmm. In Formula One for different teams.
Yeah, this was the McLaren Eagle, right? Eagle McLaren.
Exactly.
Car that was on, yeah, that we have on the slide. Yeah.
Exactly. And then in 67, he practically retired. Interesting, in 66, he had been like the cameraman. He drove a Ford GT40 prototype in races shoot some nice pictures for the movie called Grand Prix. And we will talk about this also a little bit later.
Mm-hmm. And so I think when he retired, he had a classic car renovation workshop, which was very, very successful. I think it was called Hill and Wong, right? Wong was like was his partner.
So he really discovered his passion for classic cars and classic racing. So he had this company for restoration. Also, he was a very good expert for classic cars. So he had been a lot of events, and also later after his death, his fortunes went into a trust where he, for example, also supports talents who wants to learn car restoration.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, so
1962.
In fact, 1960, even 1961.
When the problem started, right? And then, yeah.
Exactly, the problem started already in 61, and what is also known as the Great Walkout. We had a special episode about Enzo Ferrari, so we know he was sometimes not an easy boss, so he had a very direct leadership style, and normally he was expecting that that he tells you what to do and you execute this. Not that extreme, maybe as today is the cliche, it was possible to discuss with him, and he was also listening to you, at least if you had been inside his personal level of trust.
Yeah, I think when we, so just sorry to interrupt Patrick here, but when Patrick was telling us about Enzo Ferrari, and Patrick wrote two books about him, so you know, we actually showed some pictures with Mike Hawthorn, and you could actually see how, you know, kind of Enzo Ferrari sitting in the middle, and they all discuss, you know, with excitement, probably the race strategy, or I don't know, something. So you could see that even like you could tell who is the boss. Like there's still no sort of, there is no feeling that there is some tension or whatever, you know, like you could tell that everyone is really excited about working in a team. Yeah.
Exactly. So, I mean, the official reason, what was also later communicated, is that Enzo's wife, Laura, she was also in a responsible position in Ferrari, which is not that surprisingly, because at the end it's a family company, and these employees hadn't been happy about Laura's decisions. So they wrote a letter and practically made Enzo an ultimatum, saying either Laura leaving or we are leaving. And I mean, pushed that way, Enzo Ferrari practically had to back up his own wife, and so he not waited until the end of the ultimatum, but proactively separated the employees from the company. On the other hand, his marriage with Laura wasn't that happy. There had been a lot of conflicts. So honestly, I would be surprised if this was the only reason. With investigating a little bit, I also saw that these employees, they had been quite proactively also developing their own ideas. So something which Enzo maybe wasn't that fond of, and this may be another reason why he decided in favor of his wife instead of these key employees.
I wonder what decisions she could have made. Yeah, so it's quite interesting. Like I don't, you know, you hear a lot about, you know, tensions, especially like in family businesses. It happens quite often, but you know, you kind of always wonder like why. why what exactly triggered this event?
Yeah, I mean, you hear the different stories. I mean, it seems that also she was very dominant, and so quite from a difficult character, maybe even more difficult than Enzo. So there had been the problems. After all these years, to be honest, it's quite difficult to understand what really was the truth, as every side gave you different information.
Just when you said that she was quite authoritative, I'm just thinking, you know, a person who would come to the factory and say, we are dyeing all the, or, you know, painting all the cars blue. From now on, or something like that. But I mean, of course, I'm sure there were reasons, so probably more of a, you know, staff reasons or something like that. You know, maybe she was kind of, maybe she fired someone or something. Yeah, but the point is that it led to a serious, serious crisis, you know, staff crisis, essentially, within the company. And as a result, some key people left.
Yeah, and similar as Phil Hill also, Enzo Ferrari was not an outgoing person, so he personally hated to speak with the press. And due to this, practically, he limited the press conference to once a year. And at this traditional annual Ferrari press conference, he communicated the loss of these employees, also as it practically happened before this. So this was really a very traditional event with people coming from all over the world. For example, who also participated here was Luis Cinetti, who was a long-term friend and maybe the person who convinced Enzo to export his car also to the US, as it should develop into a important market for the brand. And also Luis Cinetti was the owner of the NART team, the North American Racing Team, a semi-official Ferrari team, very successful, also in endurance races. And we will see them also a little bit later in the 1960s, as they also had been active in the championship. Mm-hmm. So it was really a great workout, because you see here the names of the people who left, who have been most of them really key employees. The leader, you may say, was Geralmo Gardini. He was the commercial director, and he was joined by Giotto Bissarini, the director of controlling and testing. Also, Bissarini should found later his own sports car company.
Yeah, I remember Gardini, yeah, from company. Yep. Yeah.
And Carlo Chitti, he was the director of design and racing. After the ATS adventure, he would join Alfa Romeo and become responsible for their motorsports program, being quite successful in the prototype racing with the famous Tipo 33. And also we have other ones like Mano Della Casa, Fausto Grassi, Romano Tavoni, and Enzo Selmi. Here important for our story is Bissarini and Kitty, as they would found the ATS company. Practically these two had been involved in the development of the Ferrari 156 Formula One car. And this you can see, of course, in the design of the ATS 100. Which look very similar to the Ferrari. Their problem had been they never could get together a relevant budget, and even in the beginning of the 1960s, without adequate budget, it wasn't possible to develop a competitive race car.
Yeah, and probably the expectation was that it will be kind of the same as the Ferrari team. And obviously, when you have a new company, you have to be quite a lot more sort of flexible, right?
Yes.
And probably put in a lot of hours. And I don't think that these folks were ready to do that.
Exactly.
Yeah, after having quite a comfortable life at Ferrari.
Yeah, so these rebel employees had somehow this similar background as Phil Hill. And here you see what I've mentioned. It was the 62 Targa Florio, where he requested a change of the gearbox, and his race engineer, or was it the team manager, Romolo Tavoni, who also left Ferrari, by the way, that time he just answered that a real champion should know how to shift gears. And I mean, this was practically the last step besides the very unsuccessful 62 season, by Phil not only left Ferrari or was left. He also, the information a little bit different, but that he joined practically this rebel employees to start the RTS adventure. And by the way, RTS, it means Automobili Turismo Sportsnissima, and it's a different company as ATS in the end of the 1980s, beginning of the 90s in Formula One, which was a small German race team.
Yeah, Manto. Yeah, when we discussed 1963 season, we discussed how much this car resembled Ferrari.
Yeah.
And this is it. So on your screen, this is this ATS 100 car that was driven by Phil Hill in 1963. And practically was very, very similar to Ferrari car.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. And also what we discussed in the 63 season, RTS, the company, went bankruptcy, but maybe 2 years ago the brand was reactivated, and now if you have the budget you can buy an RTS sports car.
Car,
very exclusive. Maybe they built, I don't know, 10, 20 a year. So if you have the budget, you can Google this company.
Yes, probably not the wisest investment during the time of COVID, but who knows, you know, maybe it will be so exclusive that, you know, it will be one of a kind. And
exactly. I mean, you can be alone in your in this car, so no
yes.
Problem.
Yes, very COVID safe. If you are alone in this car.
I think there are two seats, if I'm mm-hmm. correct. I'm quite sure about that. So, but nevertheless, you can drive it alone if you want.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, and with this, we're coming to the movie Grand Prix from 1966. Quite surprisingly, this is a US Formula One
movie,
but
didn't help the popularity of the sport in America.
Exactly, but it did quite good in the movies. It was one of the 10 highest grossing film of that year, and even won 3 Academy Awards. So this I'm sure also thanks, we had a lot of stars participating, as I think the leading role was with James Gardner, but we have also, for example, Eva Maria Saint, Yves Montand, Brian Bedford, Jessica Walter, Françoise Hardy, Antonio Sabato, and Toshio Mifune, a very famous Japanese actor who participated, for example, in the movie The 7 or 10 Samurai. So a very cult movie. So we had very famous actors from all over the world, mixed up with the appearance of champions like Phil Hill, of course, as the only US Formula One champion at that time, but also Graham Hill, we see Fangio again, Jim Clark, Jochen Rindt, Jack Brabham, so a lot of drivers, which you also can get to know with our special episode here. And also some more like Dan Gurney, Ludovico Scafiotti, Richie Ginter, Joachim Bonnier, Bruce McLaren, and Joe Siffert. So really, if you're interested in motorsports, a very interesting movie to see. Unfortunately, it's not directly included in the streaming services, but I think you can see it for a small budget in opposite to the RTS car. I think you can already rent it for $3 with Amazon.
Yeah. Incomparable in price.
Yes. So maybe the first step before you buy the RTS, you can rent that movie.
Yes, definitely. As a test drive. But indeed, it had like a judging from, I haven't actually seen the film, so I need to see it. But judging from the drivers that appeared there, I mean, looks like all the stars of the 60s are in that film, so you know.
Exactly, and with this we really come directly to the cars, maybe the stars of Formula One, besides the drivers, of course. As we discussed, he started with a private Maserati, but already the same season, he got the opportunity to drive the 156 Formula 2 and the 246, so the Formula 1 car. Mm-hmm. He did quite good. Due to this, he continued with the Ferrari team for quite a while, driving in 59, the 246, and doing the same in the 1906 season. Only for one race, he used the Cooper, and this due to the fact as Ferrari traditionally avoided traveling to the US. And in this opportunities, Ferrari gave their drivers the opportunity to look for another seat to drive in the US Grand Prix. Mm-hmm. Then 61, he won the championship with 156. He stayed one more year driving this the next version of the 156, but due to the discussed reason, without bigger success, and used the opportunity for the US Grand Prix driving a Porsche 804. Then he switched to RTS, and beside RTS, he also drove a Lotus 24. As we have mentioned, because RTS wasn't able to participate at all the 10 Grand Prix, but only participated at 5. And in these 5, Phil Hill was free to look for another car, and he had chosen the Lotus. From that, he switched to Cooper, but also as Cooper, it wasn't a big success. I assume a mixture between the car. As we discussed, for example, in the 63 season, Cooper was unfortunately declining. And Phil Hill, as a driver, he was maybe a little bit more an expert on the endurance racing. He wasn't that aggressive as many others. And maybe due to this combination of reasons, he never could repeat the success of the 61 season. Then 66, the last year of his career in Formula One. And here he drove for the McLaren team. Also here, a new team, and they hadn't been able to offer a seat for each race. So he also drove the Lotus 25 in the beginning and the last race, an Eagle T1F for the new All-American racing team. But also without bigger success.
Yes, exactly. And you can see the photo of Phil Hill in 1962, right?
Driving with the number one, but unfortunately not being very competitive that year.
Yes, exactly. Well, he was a reigning champion that year. And the technology is quite an impressive list of cars that he has driven. I mean, primarily, obviously, Ferraris, but, you know, a lot of other things as well. Aston Martin and Ford and,
Exactly. So he started first with the Italian Oscar before he started 54 with Ferrari, with whom he stayed until 62. And after this, he switched a little bit between Aston Martin, Ford, and at the end, he drove the very impressive Chaparrals in the Can-Am with their big, huge wings. So, quite impressive cars if you see them. And I think he won 3 times. Le Mans had been very successful. And due to this, I think he was, based on his character, based on his driving style, maybe a little bit more an expert on these endurance races than directly in the sprint races as Formula One.
Yes, yes, and yeah, and you could actually, I mean, I'm quite impressed with the list. Must have been quite a big shift, for example, from Ferrari and Aston Martin to say Ford. But I mean, you know, like we mentioned before, I mean, yeah, there was this sort of Ford-Ferrari rivalry in Le Mans, and yeah, as an American, he probably was probably also very important for him to drive an American car.
Exactly, at least at the end of your career, we see often that drivers go to the national team or to another team with whom they have, let's say, more an emotional bonding. And with this, we come to some of his quotes. As we discussed in the beginning, he was a quite smart person. So we found a lot of words from him directly.
Yeah, and he was a native English speaker, so that helps as
Exactly.
well. I think whenever we have someone from a different cultural background, then we struggle. But in this case, yeah, a lot of quotes.
The first quote underlines what we already said in the beginning. He was more an introspective person. And so he said this also about himself: "I'm in the wrong business. I don't want to beat anybody. I don't want to be the big hero. I'm a peace-loving man, basically." So he started racing because he was, I think, enjoying the car, which also I think underlines the way he enters. I mean, he left university to become a mechanic for racing cars. So it shows, I think, that his passion was with the car. And due to this, it was logically that after his active career, he focused on restoration of cars. So I think his first passion was the machine itself, and not the competing against others.
Right, that's right. And yeah, we kind of mentioned before that he seemed to be quite an introverted person. So I'm just curious how he ended up in the movies. But then again, he is there, you know, driving essentially. So,
Yes,
yeah.
but remember, he had two roles. I mean, he participated in the movie, but mostly he was doing the shoots as being behind the camera. And of course, a US movie had to feature the US champion. So there was no way for him to say no to such an offer.
And you know, again, the sort of the it did come up in several episodes, you know, when we discussed how, you know, the drivers would finish career because they just thought that the risk was too high, right? And yeah, the second quote kind of also talks about that, where he says that I'm no longer willing to risk killing myself. Yeah, and
Exactly. This is what he said after the 61 season, after he won, but seeing that his teammate was killed. So I think this made him think a lot. I mean, I think even before, he wasn't the kind of driver always being at the limit, but maybe driving a little bit smarter, sometimes maybe a little bit slower, but due to this finishing the race and in opposite to many others surviving these years. But I mean, and maybe also this was one of the reasons why his 61 season wasn't that successful anymore, because I mean, he said it himself, he wasn't that motivated again. He wasn't willing to risk his life to win the championship or the race. And maybe without being open to risk your life, to able to win. I mean, with this, you lose some seconds each lap, and with this, you cannot win the championship, at least not in the beginning of the 1960s.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say it like when we used to talk about legacy, but I think it's good to discuss it now. So to me, I mean, he's like a real sort of professional driver, you know, like before we had people who were very passionate and kind of struggled because they were passionate and kind of were unsure because they were so passionate and very emotional. And some are probably not so emotional, but still calculating and wanting to win. I mean, this guy is basically like a contractor, more or less, right? I mean, you know, like I'm a professional. I can do this job. So it's a job, right? So racing is a job. But, you know, and it's amazing how it worked out for him, right? It did work out for him in Le Mans, just basically being very professional, very weighted and very sort of rational, you know, that way. It's like, what can I do as a professional, as an expert here? And it, you know, surprisingly also worked for him in Formula One, where we do not see many of such people. You know, I think we often see people who want to win at all costs. And, you know, really, you know, very, very fixated on winning. And, you know, in this case,
I agree that he was a very logical driver. Mm-hmm. I want to relate a little bit that he wasn't passionate, but I think his passion was driving these wonderful machines. It wasn't, maybe he was less passionate in the competition as others.
Yeah, yeah.
Due to this, he was more logical, and so not surprising that he studied business administration before becoming a driver.
Yeah, yeah. So what I meant was he had like rather professional interest, you know, like I as a kind of obviously person who liked cars. Yeah. It's you know, but in terms of his driving career, I mean, yeah, it's. It's just a job, right? I mean, to do your job well, you need to win. Yep. You know, that's kind of expected and required. Yes. But it's not really like, you know, I'm gonna be cool like by winning that. So I think, you know, I think this is the type of guy who would say, you know, yeah, I won Le Mans, so what? Right. So that's you can imagine him saying that. Yeah.
Yeah. I agree.
So like, so what? It's my job, right? It's my job to win. Yeah, yeah. So
exactly. And I mean, practically the next quote is going in that direction. If you can make sure that you always work as hard as you can on and off the ice, you will achieve your goals. It might not be instantly. It might not be next week, but you will get to where you want to be. So this shows clearly a professional mindset, which makes clear it's not about not only about talent, not only about passion, but it's really hard work.
Yeah, it's almost like, you know, professional athletics or like some other, you know, professional activity. Yeah, basically, you know, when it's not about, you know, like he said in the previous quote, it's not about being a hero. It's just a job. It's a job and I can do it well. You know, I want to do it well, you know, so I'm, in a sense, I'm a workaholic, right? So that's it. That's workaholic professional. Yeah.
Exactly. And he perfectly understands what makes a successful corporate atmosphere. Listen to people, gain advice, and gain the respect of your fellow teammates. Make sure you put in the hours and you'll have fun. So, and this is also important if you speak that he was... like an employee, he saw it as a work, but it's always important that you have fun at your work. And I think he had fun with his work.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, I don't mean that, you know, if you're a professional, you have to hate your job. No, of course not. But it's still like more of, like it is my job and I'm doing well. I'm doing it well. But if it is just a job, so I'm not going to go an extra, you know, I'm not going to go like 250%. I'm just going to be at my 100% and it will be good, you know, good performance. And if it happens to be, you know, a winning, then, you know, great. But it's, you know, it's not because I'm willing to compromise everything in order to win. Yeah, it's a very professional kind of exactly. expert mindset. Yeah.
And the practically, it continues with some quotes which you can use for all motivational trainings. For the team to be successful, we've got to set team goals. I go out every game and make sure that I'm contributing, whether that's defensively or offensively.
Mm-hmm. I mean, when I read this second quote on this slide, if you guys are listening to this or if you're watching us, I bet this is what your parents always told you. If you get your education, then you've got your platform set up for you. I definitely imagine my parents telling me this. I mean, it's pretty much like almost exactly.
You're right.
Just get your education and then you can do whatever. Like, we don't care. So just get educated. So in case this doesn't work, if in case this doesn't work out, you always have your your diploma, whatever, you know. So yeah. So it's very, like I said, you know, very kind of, if you get your education, then you get you've got your platform set up for you. Yeah.
So very rational character and not the party guy as many other, and maybe as the typical cliche of a Formula One driver.
Mm-hmm.
So it was practically the opposite of the cliche.
Mm-hmm.
And it continues. He not only underlines that it's important to go to the gym, work out, but also he underlines the importance of the correct diet. So he to look what you're eating. So he was very, very professional.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the last one I quote, I've found on different sources. Unfortunately, I couldn't identify in which aspect or where he said it. So, this is a total lack of respect of our country and our natural resources. It's sick. What has the world come to be? So, I mean, a quote very actual if we discuss environmental.
Yeah, is that about climate change? I was going to ask. Yeah,
exactly.
Maybe I'll try to look it up now. Yeah.
Yeah, so maybe you find it. And I mean, especially if we remember that he is a US citizen, this is something which, if he still would be alive, he could say in many occasions here in 2020, if we see the environmental politics here in the US. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So quite interesting quote from him, which again shows that he had education and that he wasn't limited on motorsports, but also made up his mind about other relevant topics. And I'm sure he also understood that motorsports is something beautiful, something also important, but it's not everything what we should think about.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, I don't know. I mean, I can't really find the exact context. It seems to be, has to do with over-exploitation of natural resources, but...
Yes.
Yeah,
this is thought too, but I didn't found the concrete context where he said it.
Mm-hmm.
But nevertheless, I found it interesting as this is really something which you could say today.
Yes, indeed. Mm-hmm. Yep. So, yeah. Behavior. Yeah. So we've obviously, again, discussed quite a lot about this guy. In terms of character, definitely, like I said, very professional, very weighted, very, not very emotional character, let's just say. Yeah, I mean, in terms of notable wins for him, I still think it is the Formula One win in 1961.
Yeah.
Because, you know, like in terms of, you know, Le Mans and the long distance sort of racing, he was definitely very proficient in that. And, you know, I think the Formula One championship win definitely stands out in that regard. So it's quite a quite out of line type of thing for him. So I guess that would be the notable win.
I agree, even if I think that Le Mans in the 1960s had maybe a higher importance than it has today in 2020 or for, let's say, since the 2000s. I think in 1960s, Le Mans was really something much more important than today.
Yeah, I agree. I'm just saying for his career, like since we're talking about him and his career, it's sort of more of a significant event for his career than I guess Le Mans. But obviously, I mean, if we take the effort, you know, it's probably quite a lot more demanding. So that's in terms of the win. Yeah, again, I mean, because he was so rational and not like an extreme risk taker, that's probably why, again, we do not have a good contender for, I mean, at least I don't have a good contender for an accident.
No, and if you have time and you like to dig a little bit deeper into his biography, I can recommend you this quite long article back from 1976, The Winner Who Walked Away. Mm-hmm. And here they also explain it a little bit that he maybe wasn't the best, the fastest, but he was had a lot of discipline. And
Had a method, yeah.
And exactly as you say, he had a method, and with this, on the long run, he was successful, not only on long run races like Le Mans, Sebring, but also over the time in Formula One season. And also, he was really, as you said, he never had any notable accident. Of course, it was also luck, because there could have been broken something on a car. If you're losing a wing, it doesn't matter if you drive 2 seconds slower than the leading driver. I mean, you can die also with that. So it was also, of course, luck. But I mean, he not pushed his luck. He never went that to the extreme, to the limit. He not overstepped the limit. And due to this, he was one of the fewer drivers who really survived the 1950s, 1960s.
And then, yeah, you have a nice quote on the slide, actually, and it actually says that Hill was never in an accident for which he had to be hospitalized. Yeah, so that's also kind of supports this statement about his accidents.
Exactly. And with not driving over the limit, of course, you also take care of your car. And with this, you reduce the risk that something breaks.
Yeah, we will read in a moment this quote from Stirling Moss about Phil Hill. But, you know, I also wanted to say that he's such an unlikely character, and that's probably why he's, I think, one of the most underappreciated people in Formula One. Because normally, you know, when we talk about Formula One champions, we always talk about this, like, deeply charismatic, you know, folks that are very, again, like, lots of passion, lots of emotions. Yeah. Big egos, and this guy, I mean, you know, he could have, like, you know, like Patrick, like you said, he probably could have been a great manager, business developer somewhere, and just happened to like to drive. And he perfected this skill, right? So, and it was a skill for him. It's just, you know, something that he liked to do, and he decided to make it his career. And he was very methodologically kind of training his skills as a driver, and it was his job, and he did it well. So that's probably why, like, not many people remember him in Formula One history. It's just because he was such a... But it also tells you that, you know, you can actually achieve quite a lot with obviously enough luck, being in a good team. But, you know, if you just work, you know, if you hard work actually pays off.
And with this, we are coming to his legacy. And as you said, he...
I just wanted to kind of read this quote that you found that was on the previous slide. So this is from Pat Jordan's book, The Winner Who Walked Away, that Patrick mentioned. And it says...
It's a quite interesting, quite long article. So we will put also the link directly under our video so you can... easily find it.
Yeah, that's right. Sorry. Yeah, it's the quote goes like this: as a Formula One driver, he was never the fastest in the world, but during the early 60s, he was the best. Hill, having learned discipline and restraint, finished an extraordinary 80% of the time. He was never in an accident for which he had to be hospitalized, nor did he have a reputation for breaking cars. He was a perfectionist about cars and the tracks over which he drove. And that's a quote from Stirling Moss. But effectively, you know, this is, yeah, so we're talking about effectively a workaholic, you know, professional. This is probably the most unimaginative characteristic we have given to a Formula One driver before. But having said that, I mean, you know, he was a very, very good driver, and he won the, you know, the world championship. So and he won. He was extremely efficient in long distance racing, and so you just have to admire the. So in other cases we admire the charisma and the talent and the passion, in this case we admire the hard work and the method. And this sort of discipline. This is the word, discipline.
Oh, okay, and Dr. Scaniso, with this, as you mentioned, he was really a good manager, and he had his own trust. He was an expert and lived a happy life even after Formula One.
Yeah, and you know, like you said, he was a very successful manager of his own company after he retired. But above all, he probably was a very successful manager of himself. that's a trait that not many Formula One drivers possess, definitely. But he did. Yeah. So that's Phil Hill for you.
That's Phil Hill. And this is a page, unfortunately, last time updated 2011.
Yeah.
But it's still online.
Yeah. So it's not, like we said, it's not easy to find. You will probably not find many pictures of this guy kind of just... in non-professional setting. But nevertheless, do read the article, hopefully you will gain some new knowledge about this guy. So definitely, he's definitely worth your attention.
Exactly. For this was quite interesting to speak about, as he's a quite unlikely character in opposite to others.
Yes, exactly. So again, just to reiterate, we are on all possible media, including YouTube. And do let us know if we missed anything important, or if you have a different opinion, or you have the same opinion. So we're always happy to hear your thoughts. And we will see you next time.
Okay.
All right. Thanks a lot.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.